Good evening. Welcome to this online film screening that we've been doing at the Indian Institute for Human Settlements every month now since May. This is part of the film screenings that the Media Lab at IIHS has been organizing for about 6-7 years now. But because of the pandemic, we've been doing online screenings. And as part of that, it is an absolute pleasure to be screening Shabnam Virmani's film, Koi Sunta Hai, today. And Shruti Vishwanath will be in conversation with her. I'll introduce Shabnam and Shruti to you both. I'm sure all of you are familiar with them, but I'm still going to do it. And then Shabnam will introduce the film, and then Shruti, you can take over and start the conversation. Shabnam Virmani initiated the Kabir Project Journeys in 2002. And has since been exploring the philosophy of Kabir and other mystics through a deep engagement with the oral folk traditions. Her inspiration and joy in this poetry and its wisdom has taken the shape of 4 documentary film travelogues on Kabir and a digital archive called Ajab Shahir. She also sings and performs and has done translations and curations, urban film festivals and rural yatras. And more recently, infecting students with the challenge and wonder of mystic poetry. All of Shabnam's work is part of her duties at the Kabir Project in Srishti, Bangalore. She's previously worked on gender issues through journalism, video, and radio work in the community. Thank you, Shabnam, for screening this film. These films were made a while ago, but I feel like the importance of a figure of Kabir in the times we live in and what his music and poetry spoke to is very important. So thank you so much. Shruti, thank you for agreeing to be in discussion with Shabnam today. Shruti Veena Vishwanath is a singer, composer, and educator. She sings a vast repertoire of mystic music from across South Asia with a special interest in reviving songs of women poets through composition and performance. Shruti has performed across India and abroad. She is currently focused on creating safe spaces for music community online. Shabnam, if I could invite you to introduce the film, and then Shruti, you could take over. Thank you.
Thank you so much, IIHS and Shruti, for partnering to create this opportunity online. Very briefly, this is one of 4 films that were made a while ago now, Journeys in Quest of Contemporary Living Expressions and Meanings of Kabir. Each of the films delved into a different, I like to say, duality, and in a Kabirian sense, collapsed it. So the duality that this film ventures into and tries to trace meanings between is that between high art and folk art or low art, the classical versus the folk, between urban and rural, between oral and written, between spoken and silence. And so between kath and akath, as Kabir would say. So that's what the film does. In the region of Malwa, it delves into recreating, in a sense, the life of Pandit Kumar Gandhar, in whose voice Kabir arrived in many, many, many people's hearts in the 90s, and when he sang it for the first time as a classical musician. So it tries to explore the relationship between Kumarji and Kabir. That's what the film's about.
Thank you, Shabnam. That's so wonderful to hear from you about it, because I think the remarkable thing about your work is I don't know how many filmmakers, you know, think about the longer term impact of their film, but really I think for a lot of urban people, your film has been the first entry into Kabir. Like I can name 10 names right off, right now, about people whose entry point into this 15th century mystic poet has been your films in 2008 and 2009, which I think is a phenomenal achievement. And first of all, congratulations, because that has been one of, while it wasn't my entry point for me, I think I stumbled upon your films at a time when I was also questioning the politics of music and all of these questions that you so beautifully ask. And it's been quite a remarkable anchor in these times, as I mentioned to you over the phone. It's lovely to it's lovely to dive into this conversation with you.
Thank you.
So I thought we would get started with the first thought that I had when I rewatched the film. Like, of course, Kumarji's voice is something else, and Kumarji is another presence. And as a musician and as somebody who's been deeply inspired by him ever since my childhood, for most of us, that would probably be the first thing that we would see and listen in the film. But that's not the first question I want to ask you today. Rather, my question will be about Kashiba. And why Kashiba? And for those of you, you know, who've seen the film, I'll just sort of run up to it, and maybe we'll see the clip, and then get you to speak about it. Yeah. So before this, I just wanted to point out that before this, for me, what was stark in my rewatching of the film is that there is no video plus, you know, video performance as such. There's Kumarji comes in voice. There's all of this beautiful artwork. There is Kabir Baba or Vishnu Deshmukh Saab, who also comes in voice. And earlier I thought the artistic choice was because you didn't have the video, and later on the video surfaced online. So I said, oh, you had the video. So it was clearly an artistic choice. But
yes,
the first presence that comes is Kashiba, is this outspoken Malvi female singer, and I think that's, for me, it was a choice that really brought home not only what the film stands for, but who you are, and so I wonder if we could first see the film and then
okay,
get you to speak.
Yeah,
about.
So we'll see the clip first, and then we can, yeah.
करे ताल रामा अब के मोसर लारा ले चलो ओ कोरे बाप जी गगन मंडल झूलो बांधियो ओ गरे अब ये झूले महाराज श्री भगवान रामा सहेली सहेलियां झूला दे रही आगर मरी माला रामणी याद रामा छोड़ी मत जा जो बन में एकली आगर मरी काया इरा करी गार रामा अब के मुसर लारा ले चलो बाप जी बनते मच्छिंदर गोरख बोलिया ओ गोरे अब ये पाया गे बेकुंठे बास रामा अब के मोसर लारा ले चलो ओ गोरे ये जाता है नी जब पांच तत्व होती है के माला रमणिया छोड़ी मत जाजो बन में एक काया रे करता रब के मौसल आ रहा नहीं चलो तो कहीं क्यों ने कहीं क्यों भगवान ने जब ये बोले है नहीं इसने किया ये डूंगा बेल है इसने किया के देख जिसने जोड़ी उसने तोड़ी मैं क्या जानू मैं तो ये जाता इस मकान में निवास कर रहा मैंने इसको ही छोड़ जाता इस मकान की भी छोड़ जाए ना ये ले अब ये निकली जाए ना या तू अब ये मकान डल दिया हैं अब यो या कूट दिया इसके लिए घन मथन करते हैं ये नहीं होते इसके क्या रोए काय के माथा फोड़ कर आई ये काय लो माथा फोड़ कर आई सब पेट के लिए दौड़ते हैं माँ चुटाते हो दादा हम तो सही से कहती हूँ अच्छा झूठ बचाने में
100%
जेत क्यों भाई अब ये तो करनी आनो सा देखो भाई ऐसी करनी करो बस पारो तो ये करनी करे तो क्यों डरे ने करके क्यों बसता अरे बोया पेड़ बहुल का तो आम का से
So tell us about that choice and what Kashiba means to this film. Shabnam, you're muted.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm audible now, right?
Perfect.
Yeah. So if I think about Kashiba and that one brief encounter in the chalk of Deva's town, it's not like I spent a lot of time. We met her actually precisely twice. And that episode and that encounter for me, I think, captures several themes which are central to both Kumarji's experience and his experience of Kabir. And the first I would like to highlight is the idea that she's a working class woman, you know. She's a woman who's, let us not forget that Kabir and all the mystic poets that we celebrate today and are so inspired by were all people who worked with their hands. They were not privileged elite Brahmins. They were not given to cerebrality. And I think Kashiba sort of captures that with such aplomb, the idea of a wisdom that is embodied, the idea of a wisdom that is located not here, but in every rug me, you know, all her pores speak, you know, something that she, this wisdom that she is singing about, that she is speaking about, is embodied, you know, like the way she thumps her stomach when she talks about death, you know, and that fearlessness that you glimpse in her body language means this is not an intellectual exploration of the idea of death. This is not a intellectualized or a skilled exposition through her song. It has entered her body, you know? And that is what is so, it's so Kabir, it's so Kumarji in one sense. She represents actually the class and the category of people that keep this wisdom and this poetry alive for us, and the people from whom Kumarji went and learnt this song. So I feel Kashiba's personality represents that kind of groundedness in materiality, in something that's tactile. And humor, you know, if you think about, many of us are inspired by this spiritual gyan and wisdom, and we've all encountered spiritual gurus who will have very somber, long-faced expositions of this wisdom. And I've always suspected that if you truly get the point of death being ever present in your life, it will make you smile. Nor it will not make you sad, because it will free you. It will liberate you. In fact, it's this clinging to life that makes us very somber and sad. So that impish humor that you see on Kashiba's in her persona, again, is a symbol of that sort of sense of play that you experience even in the bani of Kabir. Yeah. Baar baar unki bani mein khel ki baat aati hai, you know. Do din ka jug ma mela, you know. It's like a carnival. It's like a khel. So I think Kashiba brings that. And of course, she's a woman, you know. I think that's also important for us to remember in some sense. I think it was a Zen master who had once said in a famous koan, something like, before enlightenment, wash your bowls. After enlightenment, wash your bowls. So, you know, while we can go about our business of, you know, trying to change the world and having long political discussions, there is a quality to women which is grounded in the kitchen, in the act of nurturing, taking care, producing and nurturing life, which is, I think, reflected in the Bani of Kabir too, and many of the Sufis and mystics we love so dearly, because they were men who drew fearlessly from the feminine within them, you know. So that's why a woman needs to be there. And finally, I think she represents, in one sense, what attracts all of us to folk, you know, folk music, which is a kind of a raw, honesty, if you will. She has a quality in her singing which you may not find in other folk singers, and you may not find in many highly skilled classical singers, which is a kind of a goose flesh kind of quality, where you get a feeling that this is coming from a place of integrity, this song, you know, and it's robust, and it's going straight for the jugular, you know. It's not allowing itself to get derailed in ego masquerading and all kinds of other things that we get lost in, you know. So there is a directness and simplicity about her. My God, I could keep talking about Kashiba and what she represents, but
I could keep hearing you speak about Kashiba.
She's... yeah, you know, and every time I see this, she infuses me a little bit with that energy that this is what it's all about, you know. If you don't get to this level of internalization of this wisdom, then tum kitna bhi gaate raho aur kitna bhi is tarah bakte raho, koi farak nahi padne wala, you know. So she inspires you.
No, and for those of us who may not have visited Malwa, I've had the fortune of being there multiple times now, but this is not a sight that you see every day. Kashiba is really special because you don't, first of all, women in public space in Malwa is a very unusual thing. Women singing in public space, I mean, we can argue that things are changing, and they are bit by bit, but it's still a very, very unusual scene.
That's very true.
And what I also love is what you mentioned. I like that you get a lot of the classical musicians to also talk about that, because I also feel like in the film, the classical engaging with the folk and the folk engaging with the classical, and those conversations are also so important. Like, I love how a lot of Kumarji's disciples, I think it's Madhup Mudgal at a point, Vijay Sadeshmukh at a point, all of them talk about this and how it doesn't come by sitting in the drawing room. That sounds
awesome.
Yeah.
Yes. And I somehow felt that phrase, in the drawing room, is such a charged metaphor, because it signals the how lonely we are, in a sense, how cut off we are from the life force of nature, of the earth, in a sense, being in the drawing room. And you know, these journeys for me were as much an experience of shedding urbanity and learning from being a little closer to the elements. In the drawing room is a good phrase. It captures a lot. You know, drawing room, God, it's probably a colonial hangover too, the term itself. So yeah.
So the other artistic choice I wanted to ask you, and of course I'm not a filmmaker and I can't claim to have any understanding about how film is made, but it just fascinates me that when you see the clips of the musicians in this film, it's almost like it's a super close-up of a lot of them. Like when you film Vidya Rao, it's almost like you can see every blink of her eye, and that's crystal clear. And I wanted to ask you about that choice, because it's nice to also, I mean, a lot of people capture classical musicians in you know, and the whole setting, but it was almost as though you wanted to capture something different, like get under the skin almost, it felt. What, tell us about that a little bit. What, was it conscious or did it just...
That's an interesting question. I've never consciously reflected on that, but you're right. I like to get up close and personal. I think that's the kind of filmmaker I am. And I think that's also the kind of person I am, you know. I guess I'm a good Punjabi, you know. I like Jappi and Pappi. And I, you know, I like for us to get past the duriya, the formalities, and somehow the further away the camera goes, the more it's about unnecessary details. So it's almost like you're wanting to enter the eyes, because the eyes, there's a cliche, are a window to the soul, and that's what they say. So I don't know, unconsciously I'm trying to get to where this bani is really speaking to you. It is important for us to locate ourselves historically, socially, demographically, and see the contexts from which this poetry springs. But then you penetrate deeper where these social demographic categories of class, caste, identity, gender actually begin to shed. Because if you haven't reached that point, you haven't gone far enough. The journey has not been made long enough if you get stuck before that. So I guess unconsciously what I'm trying to do is go deeper to a place where a social context sheds. Mm-hmm. Having located it, because it is important, right?
Yeah, and I think you also, before shedding, you locate those social contexts very powerfully, and just those artistic choices of putting Kashiba front and center, of following up with three women singing in quick succession. I think all of these really reflect your choices.
Yeah, and I think I've had great fun in these movies juxtaposing unlikely contexts, you know, like allowing the very urbane, sophisticated singer to rub shoulders with a Rai Chand Ba in Lunia Kheri village speaking, to see that there is a kind of a thread of inspiration that actually makes all these categories that divide us dissolve, you know, by making these unlikely contexts rub shoulders with each other in the filmic space through the act of editing, bringing them shoulder to shoulder, you know.
I think that's also a beautiful way of embodying Kumarji's music as well, because Kumar Gandharva, I think what he stood for was that. I don't know any other classical singer. I mean, now there's plenty of people who sing, of course. But nobody who's had that kind of immersion, that kind of coming into Shilnath Ki Dhuni with torn clothes just so that he could listen to it. I don't know who will do that after him.
Yeah, very true.
So the other question that I had was the other pressing question about artistic choice I had was about the gorgeous artwork, and I'm not sure that's the word you want me to use, so I'll let you help me contextualize it, but it's these gorgeous visuals that come up with Kumarji's singing, because it's a very and as somebody who sings the Nirgun and who has also done pieces where we dance the Nirgun, it's a tricky space, because Nirgun is for the uninitiated, Nirgun is that which has no attributes, so you can't actually depict it, but you've done this this mesmerizing job of these beautiful, first of all, these close-ups of Kumarji and just juxtaposing different images. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if we could just play the Ud Jayega clip and then you tell
sure.
us a little bit about
sure.
those choices.
Yeah.
दुहेला ना जानू
That's a good question, and I'm trying to go back to those years of editing these documentary films, and I'm remembering how Kumarji's film was somehow the most difficult to edit. It was the most challenging because there wasn't a kind of a purposive storyline that unfolded. It was extremely lateral, associative, wandery, meandery, opening up questions, not providing answers, you know. And like I said to you, you know, when we were talking before this interview, I think of all the films, Kumarji's film, this film asks most the questions I still search for answers to. It's really the film of the four that is the deepest and the most mysterious, because it asks those kind of questions that perhaps reveal themselves through experience and practice. And so to come to the question of how do you represent that which cannot be represented, which is the nirgun, to make our situation even more piquant and challenging, for various reasons, we had little to no access to archival footage of Kumarji singing, and little to no access to the rich diversity of Nirgun bhajans he had sung. I remember feeling really demoralized and wondering, you know, we have all these rich conversations with people talking about Kumarji, but if we can't show him singing in video, if we can't have the diversity of all these amazing Nirgun bhajans that he has sung, how are we going to make a film out of this? Mm. And I remember going, I've told this story before, to our advisor, Ashok Vajpayee ji, saying, Ashok ji, mujhe nahi lag raha ye film ban payegi. I am feeling very demoralized. So he sort of looked at me with a challenging twinkle in his eye and he said, Nirgun par film banane chali ho, to be inspired by the poetics of absence, you know? Wow. And I think it really hit me, the idea that in fact my impulse to gather more was itself the problem. You know, this is where the philosophy and the craft of filmmaking had to see eye to eye. If I sought more and more visual representations of Kumarji and I wanted more and more, then I'm really not getting into the spirit of Nirgun at all to begin with, you know. So what does what happened? We eventually ended up using just maybe 10 black and white photographs that we got from Avinash Pasrichaji. And we worked with 3 songs. That's it. Actually, we had a few more, and we had a few more photographs, but we chose actually to go the other way and actually work with less, and to see that when you meditate on the one or on the less, it becomes everything you need. You know, when you enter that, as Vijay Sardeshmukh ji says in at the end of this film, when you enter that sa, you find all the other notes there, right? But we are so drawn by form and kalakari and this tendency to compulsively need more and more that humse ek nahi sadha jata. Ek sadhe to sab sadhe. So that turned around the approach to the film entirely for me. And then the quest became, how do we visually evoke something very subtle that is behind us? Behind us is a terrible word. It's like, what might you call the nirgun? Something that is not visible, but that's animating us, right? We draw sustenance from it. Without that nirgun energy, whether the breath or something beyond it, we would not be. Our forms would dissolve, collapse. So then you look at a photograph of Kumarji, and you slide from the sagun visible form of Kumarji into that sky-like space. And it's really remarkable how that empty space in the photographs started beckoning like the gagan. You know, because if you go closer and closer to the grains in the black and white picture, they become like stars in the sky. Or in another sequence in the film, we've gone really close beyond the lipi, the hath ke likhe shabd, beyond the words into the space between them. And again, what you just get is an abstract gray grain, you know. Mm. Or there is the Gura Tojine sequence in the film where I chose to Photoshop everybody out of the photograph. You know, his accompanists disappear, and then eventually he disappears too. And what you're left with is, again, that texture. That's all. So it became a way to notice the unnoticed, which is something Kabir asks us always to do, which is like even this breath. We're not aware of it. As you and I are speaking, I've lost connection with the breath. I'm not noticing it. And yet it's my very life force. It's my very life source. It's what animates this Panch Tattva Ka Putla, right? So how would we create an experience of Nirgun Aage Sagun Nache, Baje Soham Tur, Chele Ke Paon Guru Lage, Yahi Achambhapur. You know, I love this doha where he's saying, you know, everything that we are seeing that is visible, that is manifest, that is spoken, is like a sagun that is dancing in front of the nirgun. You know, it's like nirgun raja pe sirgun sej, which that's the raja who's watching the mujra, right? And the drums of so hum, I am that, are resounding. You are not just this form, you are also this formless energy, which we are so generally not in touch with. So I guess it all became about jhinapan, even in the aesthetic approach, to notice the details that go unnoticed, which are these blank spaces, these empty spaces, the grain, the etc. Yeah.
And it feels to me that in this process, somehow Kumarji is more alive than, you know, now there are a few videos of him on YouTube where he's singing. And yet I find myself drawn to this. I find myself drawn to that hand and the starkness of it and just, you know, sort of the uncluttered-ness of it, the nirgunness of it all, actually.
Yeah, and I think the choice of Urjaiga Hans Akela backdrop possibly came to me in a phrase, maybe from a book on Kumarji written by, I think, Raghav Menon, maybe, in which he says Kumarji's poetry and singing of Kabir evokes a landscape of loss, you know? And therefore the black and white wizened tree, because Kumarji arrives into singing Kabir through a place of silence, having lost his lungs, having lost music altogether. And when you lose, you come closer to some kind of truth, that makes it possible for you to understand and then sing Kabir, which his whole life, I think, reflected. So
it was also very interesting for me that the pace of your telling of the story of Kumarji before his shifting to Devas, the pace of it almost reflected the nature of Kumarji at that age. It was that within 6 minutes, I said, okay, where's the rest of the film? What's she going to do in the rest of the film? I remember having that thought.
Yeah.
And then you take your time and
that's true. That's so true. Actually, because that mirrors his life. Now he shot into stardom at such a young age, and it must have been felt like that for him, no? Of things packing together and being in the fast lane and rising to superstardom at such a young age. And then the collapse from that pinnacle. So in fact, there is this sequence where we go higher and higher and higher in the cutting between his photographs, pointing upwards, all his pointing hands and fingers and gestures in song. And then an LP I don't know if you noticed, there are a lot of these Jina touches in the film. At that peak of his career, we introduced the idea that he lost his voice. The camera begins to slide down. Mm. And at that point, you know, one of those LP records, those old style vinyl records, it stops and there is the sound of, you know, which is the sound you get when an LP has run its course and it's finished and someone needs to now pick up the needle and put it aside. So it became a great, the rasa of Jinapan became what infused the experience of making Koi Sunta Hai with all these.
Wow. So I have one more question with regards to this Jinapan. And it's your Jinapan in the film. Like somehow for me, out of all your four films, this was the one where you were present for sure. And the questions that you ask, all of that comes in text. But somehow we see very little of you, actually just in a little bit of your reflection in the Shilnath Ki Dhuni panel. And we hear very little of you, which changes in the other three films. So I wanted to talk you to speak about that. Why are you not as present? What was that choice about?
I wonder if that is it true I'm not there? Yes, I guess it is true. I think the answer is what I already said, Shruti. I think this is a film in which I had very little to offer because I'm completely a learner in this film. I'm wonder-eyed and gaping-mouthed, and I am full of questions. And in the other films, I have opinions. I have political stands I take in the other films. I intervene, I interject, I argue for things. I argue with Prahladji, I argue with the men in Ayodhya selling CDs of the Babri Masjid demolition. Because I'm in a place where I have something to say. Here I'm stubbed. Main sun rahi hun, koi sunta hai. So I guess as a filmmaker, I also choose to listen in the making of this film. And there was one more thing I wanted to say about the artistic choices in this film. I think the other thing that I deliberately did was to use the child prodigy video of Kumarji in Maya Maha Thagini Hum Jaane, because again, the flickering video grain became a metaphor for Maya, because that's what the nature of phenomenal reality is, that you grasp at it and before you know it, it's changed. Or it's gone, or it's actually also a metaphor for a very Buddhist metaphor for recognizing that your whole life narrative is like you at the movies. You know, it's your mind that has projected and created this reality. It's participated in it. And if you were to switch the light off and the projector off, your whole life narrative collapses in front of you. So what is truly real? What is truly solid and out there that you can trust? So it's actually an investigation of reality itself. And even the choice to zoom in deeper and deeper into close-ups is now, in retrospect, I see a very Buddhist pedagogy of penetrating into the nature of what is real. Because when you go closer and closer and you enter the parts of a whole, the whole disappears. So what is real and what is unreal? So these are the kind of questions we must ask. And I think this film asks those questions and doesn't dare to offer answers, but only points in a direction that we must journey on our own.
Wow. I wonder if we could just have a look at the third clip and then I'll...
Okay, sure.
...with my last bit of question.
दूली चंद जी, आप तो कब से गा रहे हैं कबीर?
आखी जिंदगी की बात,
आखी जिंदगी.
बिल्कुल छोटा सिख था आप, ढोल चलाते थे इस जत के, हो जत का गाते 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 ये धन हो गया.
अच्छा.
हो शब्द से मेरे की जानकारी हुई और शब्द को मैं मानता हूँ और मैं वेद, हमारा वेद है, हम वेदन में नहीं, बात खत्म. उस निर्मल को जानना है, निर्लप, जो निरालप उसको देखना है. आप भी आए हैं तो इसीलिए आए हैं कि हमको देखना है, पर ये बातें नहीं मिले, असंभव.
अलिप्त तो, उसको निर्लेप बोल रहे हैं, वो बोलने में थोड़ा उनको तकलीफ. हाँ, अलिप्त तो, निर्लेप, कहीं किसी से लिप्त नहीं, जो सबसे अलग, जो भौतिक जगत आपको दिखाई दे रहा है वो भौतिक जगत की बात नहीं है.
अच्छा,
यह आध्यात्म की बात जो है, हम आपसे भी कहेंगे कि आप भले रिसर्च करने वाले हो या कुछ भी हो, आप नहीं समझ पाएंगे. आपका ज्ञान कहाँ तक है, तो हम इतना जानते हैं कि चाहे वो आप अंग्रेजी पढ़ी लिखी, तो ऐसे जेड तक 26 अक्षरों में भरा पड़ा है. वो जो शब्द है जिसकी खोज है, जिससे ये सारी सृष्टि की रचना हुई है, या इस सृष्टि की रचना से पहले जो कुछ था वो अनिर्वचनीय था, जिसको शब्दों में बोला नहीं जाता. तो अ से लेकर के ज्ञ तक के ज्ञान, इन दोनों के बीच में क्या है? आगे से अ पढ़ते हो और पीछे से ज्ञ हो गया, तो दोनों के बीच में क्या है? उस संधि को पहचानना, उस संधि को यदि आपने पहचान ली तो आपको स्वरूप ज्ञान होगा. मुझे आप उसको जानने के लिए कितने उत्सुक है, कितने तत्व पे आप अपना क्या खो सकते हो? तो वो दुआ बोल दीजिए, वो साकी बोल दीजिए, शीश उतारे भूई धरे बोलो ना उसको.
आना कबीर पंथ में खाला का घर नाही, शीश काट भूई धरे जब बैठे घर माही.
अब आप समझ लीजिए, हम आपसे कहें, देख सकते इसी शब्दों का, आप किसी शब्दों को, तो हम आपसे कहें कि आप सिर काट के घर रख दीजिए धरती पर, तो आप उसको नहीं समझेंगे.
ये सब पढ़ाई के माध्यम से बोल रहे हैं, जानकारी काय की किताब से, और कुछ नहीं है. ये पढ़ सकते हैं, बाकी अनुभूति नहीं इनके अंदर, अनुभूति नहीं.
अध्यात्म कुछ अलग है, नाद बिंद जो है ये बीज के बारे में.
एक ज बात बताई दूंगा हूँ मारे तम तो है नहीं. जो तम मारे कितना भी भटकी जाओ, एक ज बात बताई दूंगा, आज मैं यो पलटो नहीं खा जाता, खुद नहीं पड़े. हाँ भाई, ज्ञान तो नरा हो गया, इसको पलटाना पड़ेगा. ये न्यू है, इसको न्यू करना पड़ेगा. एक ही ज्ञान है ये. अब ये ज्ञान तो छोड़ दिया हमने, न्यू चले जी गया, इनमें नहीं लगा अब. हम हमारे तो उकील लगे अब.
The layers in that clip. Oh, I'll just ask you to tell us what's coming up for you.
So I just look back at what unfolded in this sequence, and I'm amazed to see the layers that are visible here. And I was just looking at it today And I was thinking, it's quite a interesting unfolding of the natures of knowledge, if one wants to look at it that way. There I am. I represent urban educated knowledge, convent educated wisdom, and it's being called out. The colonized nature of my wisdom is being called out by the villagers, right? He said, you're not going to get it. You've just studied A to Z, yeah, and forget it. And he's right. So I think to begin with, what is being called out is the terrible and deep colonization of knowledge systems in this country. I remember going out on these journeys and beginning to recognize how impoverished my education had been thus far, even though I'm a master's, right? I felt I had been impoverished in not knowing the knowledge traditions of this country of which I'm a part. And I began to recognize how poor my education is. So first, what is being called out is the colonization of knowledge. And then what happens? There's another googly there. The school teacher in the village who has, again, had some education, is saying nothing that you can fault him on. Everything he's saying is absolutely correct, okay? Mm-hmm. But it's coming from a place of bookish learning. It's not coming from a place of embodied understanding. And I feel this kind of thing is actually the danger India is facing right now in its political history. As we sit here and speak, we are seeing a moment in history when the colonized nature of our knowledge systems has been called out by the right wing, right, in this country. But what is replacing it? An attitude of protecting our tradition, not an attitude of practicing it. And I think that is the huge difference between what Dhulichand represents, a man for whom this wisdom is embodied, and what that school teacher represents. That school teacher represents an attitude of hamara gyan to itna bada hai, and you know, a kind of valorization of the knowledge traditions of our land without practicing it, without practicing the tradition. We are trying to protect it, which is what I think the politics of Hindutva and extreme right-wing politics in this country is doing. You know, there's Vedic maths and there is this and there is that. But hey, if you really engaged with this knowledge tradition, you wouldn't care two hoots about protecting it, because then you would have the confidence that you see in Dhulichand's body. You know, because the knowledge is in his body, he doesn't need to protect it from anyone. It's when the knowledge is not in your body that you want to protect it from this invader and this problem and that problem. So I feel this sequence, without saying so, is so deeply political. You know, people often will say Had and Had and Kabira Khada Bazaar mein, these two films were the more political films. And to me, this is a very political moment in a very political film that's asking questions of what we consider knowledge, you know. And I think that gesture of Dhulichand has been interpreted in so many ways, because it's such a powerful gesture that you need to do this. You could read it as you need to look at your own land and your own tradition and understand what's here. It could speak about the self-reflexivity of knowledge traditions, which, unless they look at the self, it is meaningless knowledge at one level. So that's what our wisdom traditions brought, which was an inside-out approach. The Western knowledge traditions brought the other approach, which was understanding the world. We spoke about understanding the world through understanding the self. So understanding the self is what this gesture is speaking about. And there are so many other ways of reading that gesture. So it's just a remarkable documentary moment. You know, you can't set these things up. You quest and you journey, and you occasionally these things just come together, and you know, it's all packed in.
Wow. So I have one last question with regard to this clip, and then we'll go to, there are some questions that are pouring in. So was this one of the moments that made you also pick up the tambura as well as the camera?
Not this moment. I think the whole journey itself made me deeply realize that knowledge, again, let's link this question you have just raised with the idea of knowledge. I began to realize that I'm not going to understand Kabir unless I immerse more deeply. And to be a filmmaker necessitates that you are sitting on the bank, you know, and trying to observe the ocean. Picking up the tambura and beginning to sing is equivalent to jumping into the ocean to know what the ocean is. You know, it's equivalent to tasting that sugar, that khand, instead of trying to talk about what, you know. So to reduce that gap between observer, observed, it necessitated, if possible, to get into even just the manjiras. It doesn't have to be through singing only. You can, to get into the satsang space and stop being an outsider to it was the impulse that represented, yeah.
Wow. Thank you so much. This was so lovely. There are some questions coming in, so let me just see where we are. So Juhi has several questions. She says, after Kabir's death, he was appropriated by both the Hindus and Muslims and many other philosophical and religious traditions. So how did you resist this appropriation or authority in your artistic choices? Did that question come up for you? And if so, how did you resist it?
I do and I don't. I don't think it is possible to not appropriate. I think you, Shruti, are appropriating your Kabir as I have appropriated mine. Mm-hmm. I don't think a purely objective artistic choice is possible. I think, for instance, I cull and curate a much more women-sensitive Kabir than can be found in his poetry, because that reflects my choices as a contemporary woman. I do also choose which kinds of poems to sing, and in that sense, I appropriate my Kabir, which speaks to me and my moment. So, but having said that, yes, I know where this question is coming from. It is coming from the place which I recognized very clearly that there is no one Kabir, and in a sense, that is Kabir. Kabir resists definition. Kabir resists being put a label on. He resists domestication. So, and I think that's because his philosophy would argue that the truth itself cannot be domesticated. It cannot be labeled. It cannot be named. It cannot be branded. So his life becomes a metaphor for his wisdom. And I think that's what I tried to do right through the four films, which is to reflect the diversity of claims and show each one of them as only that, just a claim. And it's okay to claim, as you do and I do, but let's recognize that at all moments, in our attempt to write a poem about the Nirgun, that's just what it is. Your artistic appropriation of Kabir is like trying to write a poem about the Nirgun, right? We all seek to make that leap from the Kat to the Akat. And so in that sense, everything we say or do will be an appropriation.
So the second question actually goes a little deeper into your point, which is, were there points where you were uncomfortable or angry with the lyrics? And so can you point maybe to some of those examples? Or maybe you don't want to shed light on them. That's fine.
No, I mean, one of the most obvious ones that I'll immediately shed light to on is the image of Sati. The Sati, the woman who jumps into the fire, is a metaphor that does come up in a few Kabir songs, and I happily excise them from the bhajans. I've done it from one bhajan that Prahladji sang for one of our CDs as well, we removed that antra, you know, this is from...
I also remember Moon Mundave and the derogatory reference to the transgender community in one of Malvi Bhajan's.
So there are things that are inappropriate or distasteful for us in this age. And we draw distance from it. I also find a lot of poetry in the Kabi tradition to be sometimes, I would think, overly prostrating to the guru and a kind of bani that to me feels inauthentic that has been created by the oral traditions later. So yeah, you do find things you disagree with.
Okay, so there are a couple of questions on how can we bring back the focus to Kabir Shabad in our times and inspire people to practice and live it. And a question that allies with that is how relevant are Kabir's thoughts in today's world, in this crazy, fast-paced world?
Ooh, that's the sort of question I fear. Because it's the most obvious question, and yet it's in some ways a tough question to answer. How do you live it? How do you practice this wisdom? And how do you bring it to bear on the extremely bewildering times we live in, where everything is kind of getting tossed up into the wind? There is no... it seems no shared consensus about values anymore. You feel like you don't share core values with many people around you in this country. So the question arises, how do you respond? And sometimes there is bewilderment and a sense of, I really don't know. And I don't want to sound knowledgeable and opinionated. I'm bewildered. I don't know how this can respond. I only draw nourishment and inspiration from the idea that you do what you do in the here and now because it makes sense. It aligns with your value framework, which is to fan the ideals of compassion and coexistence and love and self-interrogation. These are the values that inspire us from the Kabir tradition. And you do what you can do in the here and now from this wellspring. And how it squares with the macro picture, it's blowing in the wind. Who knows? I can't answer that question.
Mm-hmm. Bob Dylan meets Kabir. So the other question that allies with this are, what are your thoughts on how we can enable children to gain these knowledge traditions? Of course, I think there's also the question of why have schools moved away from this? And I think you addressed some of that, but how can children gain an entry point into this?
So I really feel the time-tested vehicle of mass communication that pierces straight into people's hearts is the song. And I think it is no surprise that it is song that has kept alive some of the greatest wisdoms of this land. And I feel really song is one of the best vehicles to infect younger generations with this wisdom. So just taking a leaf out of the oral traditions, you just, you know, I mean, what a travesty that you have such a vast, brilliant oral tradition in this country with amazing folk traditions of this land, Sufi traditions. And school mein jaake aap kya karte ho? You all put it into a pothi, right? What a sort of irony for a voice like Kabir to put him into a pothi, into a little book, and then give them 10 dohas and say iska shastrarth karo. I mean,
and in fact, if I remember correctly, in school the dohas that we were taught was the one about the Guru
in the Kal Kare,
and that made the teacher
which one
they were superior to
which one
Govind, Guru Govind Do Khade.
Yeah. No, but then kids should have gotten back by saying, na pothi pad pad jag mua, pandit bhaya na koi. You know, you can give kids some ammunition also.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, I agree with you. The kind of even dohas that are culled out often are those very moralistic, preachy ones, yeah. Not the playful, the ulat basi, the nonsensical, the one that push the borders of cognition, take you beyond rationality. These are things that make people uncomfortable. Yeah. So, or certainly the ones that speak about caste and gender, not gender so much, but religion. Those are the ones that would make school systems uncomfortable today, especially in the current political climate of our country. So I think song, and, you know, I've often had this dream, and if somebody out there can do it, please do it. I'm throwing this out there into the ocean. Someone please pick up this idea. Why don't we have a Spik Mekay kind of movement in this country that joins or makes the connect between schools and folk singers? Folk singers in so many parts of this country can be connected to school systems in their region to bring this poetry into classrooms. And I think that would be not just a way that the children of our country will engage with a mystic's voice, they will also engage with folk music and a musical tradition. They will also engage with the amazing diversity of linguistic dialects that this land has to offer, because Kabir is found in so many dialects in this country. So the rasa of engaging with bhasha, with the beauty of language and its diversity would also happen if we did that. And if we do it effectively in really smaller town and rural areas, we will also challenge caste divides, because a lot of these folk mandalis come from what are considered Dalit or lower caste communities. To have them enter school portals as the guru is itself an important thing that needs to be done. So I think music would be the best way, but it needs... And we've started creating an online archive called Ajab Sheher, where we hope that over time this becomes a kind of a go-to place for inspired teachers, educators who want to build curriculums with this poetry. Then they don't only need to have text, they can have the orality of the tradition accessible through an online archive like Ajab Sheher. So use that too.
Yeah, and like I'm always astonished at my own upbringing, which, you know, is similar, and these knowledge systems where we also Indian culture then just becomes the classical and we ignore the folk altogether. And that's one of the things I love about this film, where it's not this or the other. It's not like you're sending a folk musician or a classical musician, but everyone engaging across.
Yeah. And I love those moments of irreverence in the film, like Kalu Ramji saying, who'll wait that long to hear the, you know, Maya, he goes. So the, you know, these things should be said, you know, these things are often felt, and I enjoy that sort of, busting holy cows.
So the last question, and then we'll probably see if something else comes up, is how did you get Kashiba to open up? What was the prompt? Did you need a prompt? And what were the conversations that you had behind the scenes that never quite...
You know, you will be surprised how many of the extremely spontaneous, delightful, meaningful moments in the four Kabir films, including walking into Fariduddin Ayaz's living room in Karachi, Pakistan, including this meeting Dhuli Chand, including meeting Kashiba, including that scene where Prahlad ji, Ajay and everybody break into laughter watching that a cappella in the corridors of some university in America. These are all, in fact, that was the very first day I met Prahlad ji. There was no behind the scenes, you know? And I think the trick is to be as unfussy as a filmmaker as you possibly can. And now digital technology makes it possible because I started filmmaking at a time when you needed a crew of 6 people and 2 men chewing gum, flashing reflectors into the eyes of some woman whom you are interviewing. You know, the setting wasn't very conducive to spontaneous, intimate sharing. But today, with the camera becoming smaller and smaller, it is even more possible for you to you know, just shed the trappings of your professional whatever and just become more relaxed with the technology. So I think the only thing I did in prepping Kashiba was to be extremely sahaj. I think I'm just sitting on the edge of that otla and just striking up a conversation, not making a big to-do, ke ab hum aapki interview lenge, and then sit her down somewhere. So she's lost all her pizzazz. By the time you hit roll button, it's all gone. You know, so to just be agile and on your feet is what I would say. So there was no prepping. I met her literally in that moment. I met her through a social worker, Dinesh, from Eklavya, who's no more, unfortunately, now. He knew of her and he said, aap kaun se milvayenge? And we had to wait till she came on her fairies, you know? We couldn't track her down easily. And many years later, when we were making small honorarium payments to all artists whom we were uploading onto Ajab Sheher, we went back looking for her. Because I had these 2 bhajans that I wanted to upload and we wanted to make her a gesture towards that. And by then, she was no more. And so then we roamed around in those chalks of Devas till somebody told us where her daughter lives. And we tracked down that house and gave her what we had to give. But like Indore Baba, Vishnu Khuprao Deshmukh, he was also a person I never met, you know. I found him through a home video recording by a resident of Indore. And through that person, we sent him his honorarium. It was really interesting. We left some money with Prakash Bhalirao's mother. And the mother said, I don't know when he'll next come. Wo chalte phirte kabhi kabhi aa jaate hain saal mein ek baar. So we said, koi baat nahi, aap rakhiye, jab aayenge de dena. And 1 year later, she sent us a message saying, "Wo aa gaye, maine pahuncha diya." You know, so these were people. This is the nature of the original tradition before the professionalization of the Kabir oral tradition in Malwa. This is how it lived and thrived.
So that sort of leads to the last question I want to pose to you today, which is, do you think you caught the right moment in history to make this film? Because so many of the people in this film, whether it's Chennaji Maru or whether it's Kashiba or whether it's Kabir Indore Baba or
Raichand.
All of these names have passed on. It almost feels like
Mukhtiar's dad, Mukhtiar's father.
Okay.
In Hadanhad, there's that really memorable moment of him talking about the sky and the body. Yeah, he's no more too. Yeah, sorry, I butted in.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you for contextualizing. So it almost feels to me that we're at this moment of change in history, for maybe because of technology, maybe because of modernization. But it almost like, even when I visit Malwa year on year and see the changes, looking back at this film, it almost felt like you had caught the right moment in time to shoot something like this and to catch all of these, I don't want to use the word old timers. It becomes so cliched, but these are people who have this, who've really learned in the oral tradition, who've steeped themselves in it. And I don't know if there is a next generation of that quality of practitioner. What do you think? Do you think you'll make another film? Do you think there is more out there?
No, you've said it quite aptly, Shruti. I feel like using a terminology I learned from Kapil Tiwari ji, where he says, you know, कि इस देश में दो किस्म की परंपराएं हैं, एक अक्षर परंपरा है और एक शब्द परंपरा. देर आर प्रैक्टिशनर्स और कैरियर्स ऑफ द ओरल ट्रेडिशन एंड ओरल विजडम ऑफ दिस लैंड हु बिलोंग टू द शब्द परंपरा. दे कैरीड अ होल, आई मीन आई कुड स्पीक अबाउट अब्दुल्ला हुसैन तुर्क हु इज नो मोर फ्रॉम ध्रब विलेज इन कच्छ, हु वॉज लाइक अ लिविंग walking, sitting, speaking, eating, smoking encyclopedia of Shah Abdul Latif, from whom we learned so much about Shah Abdul Latif, the Sindhi Sufi. And he is no more. In fact, yesterday morning I was on phone with Umar Kaka from Asariwand village in Kutch, and he had called me to say exactly what you are saying. He said, उमर का भरोसा नहीं, आप मेरे साथ इंटरव्यू कर जाइए, ये जो मेरे अंदर भरा हुआ है मैं छोड़ के जाना चाहता हूँ, आप मेरे साथ इंटरव्यू कर जाइए. एंड वी आर डिसाइडिंग नाउ टू डू अ सीरीज ऑफ इंटरव्यूज ऑनलाइन, वी आर कॉलिंग इट अजब मुलाकातें, वेयर यूजिंग जूम we are going to do conversations with many of these people and share it with audiences, because I absolutely agree with you, this is a quality of wisdom that is fast fading.
Subhashree.
Yes, thank you so much for this conversation, Shabnam and Shruti. I can speak of myself personally that I was really moved by it. And because it was a conversation so filled with insight, humor, and actually a lot of love and compassion. So I'm actually very moved by this conversation. So thank you so much. And Shabnam, look forward to seeing more of your work. Hopefully the conversation in Ajab Mulaqate. And Shruti, I have never attended your performance yet, but I really do hope to in future, the next time I visit Bangalore. And thank you all to the audience, Avay, who had some wonderful questions. I know many of them were even requesting Shabnam to sing and Shruti to sing. Is that something either of you would like to do? I mean,
I'm not prepared.
Okay, that's fine. So a little bit of... the next month, we're going to be screening the film Cyclotron on 20th November at 7 p.m. The film is made by Janhvi Phalke, and she will be in conversation with Aroma Revi. If you would like to register, please register for the film screenings. But this was truly a delight, and I really hope we will be uploading this conversation, so many more people, I hope, will watch it, and I hope it and engage with us. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for making this possible. And thank you, Shruti. Really enjoyed chatting with you today.
Likewise. Thank you, Shruti.
Bye. Have a good evening to everyone.